Dear God, thank you for waking up us today. Thank you for this opportunity to be here together to study your Bible. I ask you for your Holy Spirit to be in the midst of us, and we may understand and comprehend the spiritual things. I ask you to guide our minds. This is me.
I want to show you something here about this sermon. The sermon wasn't that. I'm not making a big deal about my involvement with the sermon. The implications of that sermon on Sabbath does something. I haven't ever seen anything like this, but anyway. This passage from Great Controversy, we don't have to read all the way through, but I want it in your memory bank for a point of reference. The first two paragraphs are pages early on. By that I mean the first paragraph is page 574, the second paragraph is page 586, and then the rest of the article is page 588 to 592. You have all this on the first three pages of your notes. Okay, so the first paragraph, I want you to see this, let it sink in. This is where she says, if the reader would understand the agencies to be employed in the soon coming contest. Okay, this is where she says, if you're going to understand the characteristics of the Sunday law test, then you better have to go back to the early church. In the next paragraph, she goes to 321 with Constantine passing the first Sunday law, and then she gives a history of the growing exaltation of Sunday worship and the growing pressure that's put upon Sabbath worship. You follow me? So this first paragraph is a paragraph that we use as a point of reference to make the argument that the characteristics of the Sunday law are also illustrated in the Midnight Cry, because at the Midnight Cry, we have the first of a series of Sunday laws. Okay, so the Sunday law of Revelation 13:11. So my point is in this, and you got to get this point, because if you don't follow this point, you may think I'm just pulling things out of the thin air. This passage is going through a couple chapters in Great Controversy, but here she says, okay, if you're going to understand how the Sunday law comes in, you have to understand how it came in the early church. And she continues on with this narrative, and I threw a paragraph in from another page along the way, which is a classic one, where she says, courts of justice are corrupt. Rulers are actuated by desire for gain and love of sensual pleasure. That will be the political, legal environment when the Sunday law arrives. And they are. They are corrupt. Okay? And rulers are actuated by the desire for gain. Okay? They're not the only ones, but look at the Clintons. The money that they have made since they left office is unreal. Can you imagine? This one just always rubs me the wrong way. I don't care about making money on Wall Street, okay? But who was the famous woman that went to prison for insider trading?
Martha
Stewart gets thrown in prison for a little bit of insider trading, okay? But in the Congress of the United States, it is legal. It is legal to have information and do insider trading. The Congress has allowed them, they have passed a law that it's okay for them to do insider trading. And they go in there and they get filthy rich. Because they know in advance that tomorrow this drug is going to be found to cause birth defects and cancer. So they know to get out of that pharmaceutical company a day in advance before everyone else takes a big wash, you know, or gets wiped out. They know those kind of things, and they can't do anything. They don't do anything to stop them. So this is the environment we are in. Rulers are actuated by desire for gain and the love of sensual pleasure. Do you know any rulers in the United States that have a character that's known for their love of sensual pleasure? Okay. So this is the environment that's in place in the Sunday law crisis. When you get arrested and you go into the courts of the land, you you need to know you're not going to get a fair trial. So you're not going in there for justice. You're going in there to witness.
And so in that last quote, you just read that they gain by perjury, which is lying under oath. So not only are the courts corrupt, but the Adventists that go into the courts are going to commit perjury.
That's true, but that's not what she said in that last quote that we were reading. She was saying that they would hope Jesus would perjure himself. Yeah, they were hoping to bring him in to get him to say something that thereafter they could say he lied. But it doesn't matter. They're going to perjure themselves. Okay. So now those first two paragraphs are from early on in this passage of the Great Controversy. So now we cut in to a long passage. The third paragraph through two great errors, the immortality of the soul and sudden sacredness, Satan will bring the people under his deceptions. This is a classic, important paragraph. But here's what I want you to see, and some of you may have already understood at least part of this before. I never got it. And as I've went in and looked at it over the past day, I think it's pretty valid. Paragraph 4, we'll read it in. We'll read paragraph 4 and 5 and then discuss it. Whose turn to read?
As spiritualism more closely imitates the nominal Christianity of the day, it has greater power to deceive and ensnare. Satan himself is converted after the modern order of things. He will appear in the character of an angel of light through the agency of spiritualism. Miracles, thank you. Will be brought, the sick will be healed, and many undeniable wonders will be performed. And the spirits will profess faith in the Bible and manifest respect for the institutions of the church. Their work will be accepted as a manifestation of divine power.
Okay, now what I want you to see is we have taught correctly for a long time that at the Sunday law, then Satan appears to personate Christ. And for me, what I've recognized and wondered about for a long time in terms of the miraculous deception that goes on here, here Satan appears as an angel of light. Here he appears to personate Christ. There's two activities that he does. And Sister White talks about preachers or persons coming and deceiving people by becoming an angel of light unto them. So there is pastors and people that will fulfill this prophecy about an angel of a light appearing. They already have. It's happening now. What I'm saying is this particular revelation here is saying that just as at the Sunday law in the United States, then Satan appears to personate Jesus, that at this Sunday law, he appears as an angel of light. And she's clear he's going to be a doctor. He's going to be a doctor, she says. He's going to come as a physician, and he's going to do miracles and wonders, and he's going to bring the religious world together as he does so. There's going to be a great, great revival, okay, that we're not seeing. And it begins here. It begins right here. Whereas up until from my understanding, there may have been people that already knew this, but from my understanding, until we got to the level of fractals and we begin to see that the characteristics of the Sunday law are typified in the characteristics of the midnight cry, we didn't have a point of reference that would allow us to say that Satan actually appears here now as an angel of light. And if you look closely, I've looked at all the angel of lights in the spirit of prophecy and some other lines. Sometimes you'll speak about Satan appearing as an angel of light, and then in the very next thought in the sentence, without even breaking the sentence, you'll talk about him personating Christ. But if you read carefully, she never puts an "and" where she says he's an angel of light and personating Christ at the same time. And if you're not looking for it, you don't see it. Okay, so that's the one and only one of the arguments that I want you to see in here. Notice, we've already put in the record The threefold union of the beast, the dragon, and the false prophet, it takes place at the Sunday law, right? This is where the United States stretches forth its hand across the gulf to grasp the hand of the Roman power and reaches across the abyss to take the hand of spiritualism. This takes place at the Sunday law, but notice this next paragraph, what takes place, I'm saying, back here. Heidi?
The line of distinction between professed Christians and the ungodly is now hardly distinguishable. Church members love what the world loves and are ready to join with them, and Satan determines to unite them in one body and thus strengthen his cause by sweeping into all the ranks of spiritualism. Papists who boast of miracles as a certain sign of the true church will be readily deceived by this wonder-working power, and Protestants, having cast away the shield of truth, will be also deluded. Papists, Protestants, and worldlings will alike accept the form of godliness without the power, and they will see in this union a grand movement for the conversion of the world and the ushering in of the long-expected millennium.
Here is a threefold union. Papist, Protestants, and worldlings. And the worldlings are spiritualism. So there's a threefold union. Here. That's accomplished by Satan appearing as an angel of light and doing a wonderful work in the cities as a medical missionary. He's going to be doing healings. And the reason why does he have such a wonderful field of work in the cities? Pardon me?
They're all sick.
They're all sick. They're not just all sick. They're under massive bombardment from the judgments of God. Okay, the cities are being, and there's a religious movement in this time period that is healing people and doing miracles as these cities are being suffering the judgments of God. He has the populace is prepared for a savior in a big time way. Okay, so anyway, take note of the last paragraph I want you to see here.
On
I'm saying he's a singular God. But I'm not locking it into that, because when you go into Satan personating Christ after the Sunday law, she says that there will be appearances around the world. Okay, so is he a singular guy or whatever? That's kind of vague. But I'm saying he comes as an angel of light right here. He's the glue that produces this counterfeit revival and reformation that they believe is going to usher in 1,000 years of peace, a millennium. Because this is the very first and the biggest argument that William Miller had to deal with in his history. He was teaching that on October 22nd, 1844, the Lord's going to return, and he was countering the Protestants that believed that when the Lord returned, there was going to be 1,000 years of peace. So we're right back to this same argument right here. We're going to be arguing the millennium. These people think the work that they're doing in the cities with this revival and reformation is going to produce the Jubilee millennium. But I want you to go to page 3. The last paragraph on page 3 is in a sequence of things. You could read through here where we left off, and she's speaking about this history, and you until you have fractals, you really don't have a good point of reference for placing this history in the right place. But the things that she's saying in these paragraphs are going in here. And then notice this last paragraph. Brother Theodore, last paragraph, page 3.
The dignitaries of church and state will unite to bribe, persuade, or compel all classes to honor the Sunday. The lack of divine authority will be supplied by oppressive enactments. Political corruption is destroying love of justice and regard for truth. And even in free America, rulers and legislators, in order to secure public favor, We yield to the popular demand for a law enforcing Sunday observance. Liberty of conscience, which has cost so great a sacrifice, will no longer be respected. In the soon coming conflict, we shall see exemplified the prophet's words. The dragon was wroth with the woman, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ.
What I'm saying is this illustration of events that are about to take place, it leads to here. That's what this paragraph is saying. This is where the Sunday law comes together. So the events that are before that are events in here. I want to read one more paragraph, and then I'll take the hands that I see. It's on page 2. It's in the middle of this illustration of these events. It's the third paragraph, and I'll start with the third sentence. It will be declared that men are offending God by the violation of the Sunday Sabbath, that this sin has brought calamities. The calamities are going on in here, which will not cease until Sunday observance will be strictly enforced. That's here. That's over here. And she continues on, and then she gets to the point where she's saying that church and state are going to unite. So my point is this history here is before the Sunday law, and there's already been a threefold union between papists, Protestants, and worldlings that has been brought about by an angel of light appearing and doing miracles and wonders. Brother Tyler.
If you go to the paragraph before, the one you just read, the bold there, it's saying exactly what you're saying. While appearing to the children of men as a great physician who can heal all their maladies, he will bring disease and disaster. In the next quote,
until popular cities are reduced to ruin.
Well, yeah, and that. But the next quote is the one you just read, which leads to the Sunday law. So she's saying before Sunday is strictly enforced, he appears to the children of men as a great physician.
Yeah, in this history, and as he's doing his miracles, the populated cities are being brought to ruin. Okay.
By his word.
By him. Yeah, by God allowing him to do what he did with Job.
On page 3, where we read about rulers and legislators in order to see public favor, we yield to the popular demand for law enforcement Sunday observance. When you go into those courts, you're going into a veritable lion's den. You're going in there to witness. Yeah, it's they're ravenous beasts, and they're not there to administer justice, they're there to bring you down.
Yep.
I was just gonna say that the rule in this relation is that the Sunday law, national
apostasy is followed by national ruin.
Your point is that men are crying?
National apostasy is followed by national ruin. It's progressive. It's going to be end of the road here. This is the end of the United States. It's so bad. But here, national apostasy is followed by national ruin. This is what happens here. Even if you just use the application that Islam is going to strike here, it's going to be something profound. But that isn't my point that I'm getting at. Go ahead.
The only thing that gets in my mind is like, how Islam, because you know that the church are going to say, they are keeping the Sabbath, that's why the judgment of God is falling upon the cities. How they're going to associate Islam being attacking USA with the keeping the Sabbath people? It's like here.
I don't know.
Just after the says the ruin and desolation, the second paragraph, and talks about a lot of natural disasters also. So.
So.
It's not just Islam; it's some natural disaster.
Also. Yes. Yeah. The four winds are Islam, but the four winds are natural disasters, and the four winds are the armies of the world. If you go into the spirit of prophecy, it's all of them. But we more often than not are looking at the four winds as the role of Islam. But it's many things. If you t- took the time to read the notes from the sermon, the four sore judgments of Ezekiel, sword, pestilence, famine, and evil beasts. Evil beasts. What do those mean? Because the judgment is going to be perfectly put in place here, but it's got to begin back here. What's a sword? War. Judgment. This is war. Okay. One thing that really hasn't happened to the United States, it has, but it really hasn't. I mean, with 9/11 and Orlando and San Bernardino, these things that have happened, I can't really say this. But typically, through the warfare of the 200 plus years of the history of the United States, we don't get attacked. The war takes place over in Europe or Africa or Asia, and the United States doesn't get attacked. Here, the sword is going to be in the United States, and I don't think it's just going to be these little, and they're not little, but I mean Orlando, 49 people, I think it's going to be hundreds of people, so little in that sense. The sword's coming, famine's coming. How do you get into a famine situation in the United States? One easy answer is shut the trucks down because the stores are empty in 72 hours if people don't panic. If people are panicking, the stores are empty in a matter of hours. And if the trucks aren't running, and if you're going to get into the detail of this, in this crisis where this happens in the United States, one of the drums that Sister White always pounds is labor unions. Is the trucking industry controlled by a truck labor union? Yes. Teamsters. So all of that, this is plausible, but this isn't where I want to go, Arian.
She says here also in the second paragraph you just read, she says halfway, he sweeps away the ripening harvest and famine and distress will follow.
Yeah, there is definitely a literal famine, literal sword, whatever the pestilences are, or the noisome beasts. What are the noisome beasts, the evil beasts? Okay, so there's a lot of, but I'm saying that these four judgments begin here. The perfect fulfillment is here, but because this is a Sunday law.
Literal locust,
yes. Okay, could be. All right, so that isn't my point. Notice the on page 4, and it is Kathy. Page 4, Fallen Angels, Judgment in One Day.
Fallen angels upon earth form confederations with evil men. In this age, Antichrist will appear as the true Christ, and then the law of God will be fully made void in the nations of our world. Rebellion against God's holy law will be fully ripe, but the true leader of all this rebellion is Satan, clothed as an angel of light. Men will be deceived and will exalt him to the place of God and deify him. But omnipotence will interpose into the apostate churches that unite in the exaltation of Satan. The sentence will go forth. Therefore, shall her plagues come in one day, death and mourning and famine, and she shall be utterly burned with fire, for strong is the Lord God who judges her.
Now the next paragraph is not really germane to what we're studying, but it's a really cool paragraph. But Tyler wants to say something first.
Does, in that first paragraph, she says, fallen angels upon the earth, let me find it. She basically says that, does Satan appear before the Sunday law, or in terms of at the Sunday law? I know we're talking about the Midnight Cry, but Sunday law then Satan, or Satan then Sunday law?
Satan personates Christ here.
Yeah, that's my point, but is it when the law of the Sunday law is made, is it before that to encourage it, or right?
No, that's the point. That's the point. When you go into the Spirit of Prophecy and do a line upon line search for every reference that she makes to Satan personating Christ, he's doing, if there's any comment at all about the Sunday law, sometimes there isn't, but if there's any comment about the Sunday law, it's the same as in here. She says he's going to the nations of the world. You never find one reference where she talks about Satan personating Christ in order to push the United States to pass a Sunday law, because they've already passed the Sunday law before he personates Christ. And then his efforts is to get the other countries to come in line with the United States. That's the point here about him being an angel of light here. He's not personating Christ back here. He's personating a medical missionary. I mean, she says he will appear as a physician. Okay. But the next paragraph, short, but it's really nice. Carol?
The object of preaching is not alone to convey information, not merely to convince the intellect. The preaching of the word should appeal to the intellect and should impart knowledge, but it should do more than this. The words of the minister should reach the hearts of the hearers.
Okay, now here's an argument that I tried to make on Sabbath, but I didn't have this quote. Read this quote, this paragraph, Brother Bud.
Wonderful scenes with which Satan will be closely connected will soon take place. God's word declares that Satan will work miracles. He will make people sick, and then he will suddenly remove from them his satanic power. They will then be regarded as healed. These workers of apparent healing will bring Seventh-day Adventists to the test. Many who have had great light will fail to walk in the light because they have not become one with Christ. His instruction is not palatable to them.
Okay, so here's the point. Here's the test that Adventism get brought to, the Sunday law test. Here, as a Seventh-day Adventist in the United States, you either get the seal of God or the mark of the beast. We're at the end of the priest and the Levites. This is the 144,000. Your character is set for eternity, one way or the other at this point. So false healings are not going to be testing you anymore. That's a past tense for you. The false healings are in here, and this is what brings Seventh-day Adventists to the test. In the false healing is a false reformation. And you and I, if we're faithful, are going to have to be telling everyone why this guy that has this miraculous power that has brought Christianity together, that's having a movement for the conversion of the world, and he's healing people, and he's doing miracles, we get the privilege of explaining to the world, with the thus saith the Lord, why this is Satan. Whoa.
It's just why it says the great test for God's people is the image of the beast test.
By which their eternal destiny.
Yes, so Seventh-day Adventist has to recognize what Satan is doing. He's contributing to this forming of an image of the union of church and state, with the church in control of the relationship, an unholy alliance. We have to, as you said, recognize that and tell people this is satanic. But they won't. They'll get caught up in it. And therefore, when they come...
Why?
I think they're ready.
Okay, I'll answer that question. It's in the paragraph that whoever just read. Because
works of healing,
because his instruction is not palatable to them.
Yeah.
What does that mean?
It doesn't taste nice.
Right. Their instruction began back here at 9/11, the little book, and they refused to eat it. And because they refused to eat the little book, they will not have the spiritual discernment to make the right call on this angel of light. It's not palatable to them. We're still not to where we need to be. Sister Michelle.
Are we saying that this situation that's happening is happening before or after the image of the beast?
It's happening during the image of the beast testing.
Yeah.
During. Because in my mind,
progressive.
Between midnight and the midnight cry, what we were reading before about Jesus and, you know, being called in, would that be happening at the same time? I was thinking that was happening before. Between midnight and the midnight cry, where to me they've already passed, or they've already failed.
Who's passed?
the Adventist Church.
The Adventist Church isn't done here.
I know that all of them are done, but they're already in part of the image of the beast test because they're trying to accuse God's people to the state to make sure that...
Yeah, but there's 7,000 that haven't bowed a knee in here, the Levites, that they're going to choose between this angel of light and the ensign that is lifted up from this history.
Absolutely. Okay.
Okay.
I'm thinking Satan is doing miracles and healing people, making sick people better, etc. Is this also a test in the sense that Seventh-day Adventists will be connected with it? My question is,
that's the Omega apostasy is part of this wonderful work in the cities, and the Adventists are right there, front and center.
Yeah, because we have the reform, the health message. Do we have a false, or is there a false reform message connected with it?
Well, the one paragraph from the Great Controversy that we started with earlier on, in page 1, paragraph 4, Papists, Protestants, and worldlings will alike accept the form of godliness without the power. Here, when this angel light comes, there's going to be a threefold union between papists, Protestants, and worldlings. Is the Seventh-day Adventist Church a Protestant church?
Yes.
There's going to be some Adventists that are involved with this. In fact, Sister White, another place that we've dealt with, say that the nominal church and nominal Adventists are going to come at midnight to have the faithful priests arrested and take them to the Catholics.
The active part of the Adventist Church in disasters is Adra. Mm-hmm. I would see it more perfectly represented by Adra's involvement with the disasters. They're involved with all the major disasters in the United States.
Well, what's Adra?
Address
involved with the papers. Yeah, Relief Association or whatever, but what is it?
It's our disaster relief.
It's connected with the dragon power.
It's connected with the Ten Kings, right.
But just because it receives its stamp of approval doesn't mean that's the only part.
Can two walk together?
I'm just saying, it's connected with all three, the papists, the Protestants, and the worldlings through ADRA.
Yeah, really though, this is all important stuff. It's not where I want to be, Brother William, Brother Daniel.
I've always wondered, how is it possible that lifelong 3-4 generation Adventists could possibly do this? And now I know clearly why. I mean, these judgments of God are falling, people are sick, there's calamity all through the cities, and because in that previous quote on page, I think it's page 4, where it said that his instruction is not palatable to them. Mm-hmm. And you look at the debates before the General Conference in many of the large churches on women's ordination, and that was not palatable to them is an understatement. Mm-hmm. I mean, there were people pointing fingers and...
Okay. I'm going to cut you off. You're right. It's all... Did you have something to point to the point, Andrew May, to what we're dealing with?
When it says... Baptists, Protestants, and worldlings will alike accept the form of godliness without the power. Isn't it before midnight, right? Because they don't have power here. And they will see in this union a grand movement for the conversion of the world and the ushering.
The first part says he appears as an angel of light.
Yeah.
Okay. Where does Satan appear and call fire down out of heaven? Over here. Okay, so the appearance of Christ, the appearance of Satan personating Christ comes after the Sunday law. Therefore, the appearance of Satan as an angel of light comes after the midnight cry. But yes, the people that are going to get caught up in this delusion, they've already made their choices. They're already living a religion but denying the power thereof.
Okay. Just to make the connection, so we are saying that imminent cry is going to happen, the national disaster in Islam, and then he appears as Christ.
He appears as an angel of light. I'm making a distinction.
At the Sunday law.
At the Sunday law.
Start the healing.
No, this is, he as an angel of light, he's going to do miracles and wonders.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. How is he going to make miracles and wonders if they have no power?
He does have power.
The power that they're speaking about there is the whole, the presence of the Holy Spirit that gives you power to have a victorious life. They are professing godliness, but denying the power. Godliness is produced by the indwelling Holy Spirit. Okay, different power. Let me move a step further on. Notice in the next paragraph. I'm on page 4. Works of apparent healing will bring Seventh-day Adventists to the test. The reason they fail the test is because they haven't been eating the little book. The message wasn't palatable to them. And then in the next paragraph, she says, study the 6th chapter of John. And then she gives us a little study on the 5th chapter of John. She says, study the 6th chapter of John, but she's going to quote from the 5th chapter of John. But my point is, what's the 6th chapter of John? It's thou shalt eat the flesh, meet my flesh, and drink my blood. It's about the fact that they weren't eating it.
And they walk no more with
him. And they walk no more. It's a separation, but also it has to do with whether it's palatable or not, okay? And then history will be repeated. We could go into to a little bit more than that, but now let's consider the cities here. And we won't get through this. But whose turn to read? Bud, you want to say something?
No, I was cracked.
Okay. Did you read, Stephen? Read. Oh, that God had a sense of the impending destruction.
Oh, that God's people had a sense of the impending destruction of thousands of cities, now almost given to idolatry. But many of those who should be proclaiming the truth are accusing and condemning their brethren. When the converting power of God comes upon minds, there will be a decided change. Men will have no inclination to criticize and tear down. They will not stand in a position that hinders the light from shining to the world. Their criticism, their accusing, will cease. The powers of the enemy are mustering for battle. Stern conflicts are before us. Press together, my brethren and sisters. Press together. Bind up with Christ. Say ye not a confederacy. Neither fear ye their fear, nor be afraid. Sanctify the Lord of hosts himself, and let him be your fear, and let him be your dread. And he shall be for a sanctuary, but for a stone of stumbling, for a rock of offense to both the houses of Israel, for a gin and for a snare to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and many among them shall stumble and fall and be broken and be snared and be taken.
So there is a confederacy right here of papists, Protestants, and worldlings. But Sister White's saying we're supposed to press together and bind up with Christ and not get involved with this confederacy. And at this time period, the cities are going to get wiped out. Oh, that God's people had a sense of the impending destruction of thousands of cities, almost given fully to idolatry. Okay, let's, comes as an overwhelming surprise, but let's drop down to the next quote from Councils.
This is doubling, press together.
Yeah. Yep, press together, here. I think this is also in, maybe it's not in Country Living. Read the entire thing for us, Brother Arian.
Out of the cities is my message. Our physicians ought to have been wide awake on this point long ago. I hope and pray and believe that they will now arouse to the importance of getting out into the country. The perils of city life. The time is near when the large cities will be visited by the judgments of God. In a little while these cities will be terribly shaken. No matter how large or how strong their buildings, no matter how many safeguards against fire may have been provided, let God touch these buildings, and in a few minutes or a few hours, they are in ruins.
Well, what does that make you think of? Yeah, okay, go ahead.
The ungodly cities of our world are to be swept away by the
besom
of destruction. In the calamities that are now befalling immense buildings and large portions of cities, God is showing us what will come upon the whole earth.
So what was he showing us at 9/11?
That it will happen on the whole
earth. Yep, it's going to happen on the whole earth.
Besom, a broom made of twigs tied around a stick. The dirt brush man's going through.
Okay. Cool. Keep going.
He has told us, now learn a parable of the fig tree. When his branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, ye know that summer is nigh. So likewise ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it, the coming of the Son of Man is near, even at the doors.
What is that?
Buttering.
It's a sign.
Luke 21.
What was the problem, and this is where we're getting to what we were looking at within the past week or so, about are all the signs in the last reform movement of the 144,000, are they the sign of Jonah? And what is the sign of Jonah? And is it okay to say that they're all the sign of Jonah?
Yes.
Okay. And there's lots of elements to the story of Jonah, isn't there? They have Seventh-day Adventists there that are in a Laodicean condition that have been commanded to take a message to Nineveh, the destruction of the world, and they head off to Tarshish, and Tarshish is a symbol of economic strength. So these Laodicean Adventists, they decide that they're going to seek financial support in a time period when they're supposed to be carrying a message to the world about the soon coming destruction of the world. And what hits Jonah? An east wind. And the mariners are afraid, and then Jonah's thrown into a binding off period with 3 days and nights in the belly of a whale. Okay, and Jesus said to the Jews, this is the only sign that is given to the Jews, and in that sense, it's the only sign that's given to us, but there are many signs. I see your hand, Brother Daniel. Go ahead, but I'm going to move fast here. Go ahead.
No, I don't know if you can apply like this, but when it says, we know that the summer is nigh. Midnight Christ is the summer.
Summer is the harvest.
Yeah, but...
So...
But it's the harvest.
Here, back here...
And the midnight Christ is...
You had to see the budding trees of spring. This tells you you're the last generation, and the summer is nigh, the harvest is nigh. This is harvest, harvest, harvest.
I'm making parallel with Millerite history.
And
cry is at the summer. I don't know. If
oh, okay. You're using the literal season of that time.
Yeah.
Okay. My point is this. Back here in 1989, do we see Islam in this? Do we see a sign of Islam here?
Yeah.
What is it? Okay, the alliance, you guys are going to that history. I'm talking about that Jesus is born at the time of the end, and there's a star in the east that leads the wise men from the east here. Okay, the sign that's associated with the birth of Jesus is a sign of the time of the end. So there is a sign with the time of the end, and you have prophetic justification for seeing Islam connected with it, even without going to the history of 1989. Is there a sign of Islam with 9/11? Okay, is Islam involved with the Midnight Cry and the Sunday Law, just based upon the story of Balaam, we have all three of these. So what I'm saying is that Jonah is, the sign of Jonah is a symbol of all the elements of the third angel, of the three angels' messages. It's all there. Islam, the empowerment that comes from the Holy Spirit, the binding off, the three-step testing process. So when Jesus says the only signs given is the sign of Jonah, it's correct, even in our history, all the way through. Okay, but we use Luke 21 And Sister White just referred to it in connection with getting out of the cities. We use Luke 21 to say that at 9/11, we had to see the activity of Islam in order to understand that the latter rain is beginning to sprinkle and eat the little book. Yes? Okay, so go to the next quote. And, well, next quote. This is where Sister White commenting on Luke 21 says, Christ had bidden his people to watch for the signs of his advent. So Luke 21 is definitely a sign. And he pointed his followers to the budding trees of spring. And in the next quote, it says, the rain that begins to sprinkle here only falls on those people that recognize it. You have to recognize it. It's a sign. Okay? So, notice, Sister Michelle, the quote under trapped. This, wrap your mind around this. This is a key point.
Our restaurants must be in the cities, for otherwise the workers in these restaurants could not reach the people and teach them the principles of right living. And for the present, we shall have to occupy meeting places in the cities. But ere long, there will be such strife and confusion in the cities that those who wish to leave them will not be able. We must be preparing for those issues. This is the light that is given me.
When does the strife and confusion hit the cities? Right here.
Midnight.
Midnight cry.
Midnight cry.
We're not worried about arguing the subtleties of midnight and midnight cry right here. This is, what does that mean? This is the last opportunity for Seventh-day Adventists to get out of the cities. When this Sunday law hits, you either you drop what you're doing, like the story in the time of Christ, and you walk away from all your possessions in the city and your children and your spouses that won't come with you, and you get out of the city then, and you're going to find that you made a terrible mistake. Because, yeah, you're going to get out of the city and perhaps you'll be saved, but you're going to get out of the city and have to go find someone to live, some place to live like a bum. Not necessarily like a bum. You're going to have to find some Seventh-day Adventist that's willing to take you in when you have nothing to offer because you squandered it all living in the city. If you don't get stop right there when this Sunday law hits and get out of the cities, you will never be able to get out of the cities. You will die in the city. Maybe there's a way the Lord is going to interact with you where you're saved, but you're going to die in the cities. Okay, so what if you can prove this, and you can, we're not going to get to it, but you can, what it means is what has opened up is now the message that we, to get our head of flint prepared, the message that we need to give to the Seventh-day Adventist Church is we're on the verge of a sudden, unexpected Sunday law in the United States, and at that point, if you're still in the city, you're going to die. That's a pretty profound message. Pretty serious message.
She was telling us 100 years ago.
Out of this country living is one aspect. That's not my point. My point, as a messenger now, you have to say that we are on the verge of the first Sunday law, and when that first Sunday law hits, you have to leave the city immediately or you'll never get out. Look at what's going on in Venezuela. Are you following what's going on in Venezuela? The protests get bigger each day because there's no food. They're starving to death. And those cities, you ever been to any of the cities in Venezuela? I've been to Caracas. You wouldn't want to be in Caracas when they run totally out of food. It's going to be crazy there. We have current illustrations about what's about to take place here. And Seventh-day Adventists, at the same time, they're going to think everything's all right because they're going to be participating in this wonderful counterfeit work that's going on in the cities where people are being healed that need to be healed, not just from diseases, but from the catastrophes that are causing such grief and pain. Okay, notice the next quote, the image of the image test. Someone brought this up briefly. Sister Carol, who will be warned? The image test? Oh, sorry, I have to make that distinction.
Oh, yeah.
Got two Carols.
The image test, who will be warned? We say again, out of the cities. Mm-hmm. Do not consider it a great deprivation that you must go into the hills and mountains, but seek for that retirement where you can be alone with God to learn His will and way. I urge our people to make it their life work to seek for spirituality. Christ is at the door. This is why I say to our people, do not consider it a privation when you are called to leave the cities and move out into the country places. Here there await rich blessings for those who will grasp them. By beholding the scenes of nature, the works of the Creator, by studying God's handiwork, imperceptibly you will be changed into the same country.
Those people that are in the country in this time period will be changed into the image of Christ. But the context of this passage, what happens to those people that stay in the city? They're changed into the image of Satan. All I'm saying is that this history here is where the image of the beast or the image of Christ is finalized for God's people. It's consistent with this image of the beast testing time.
It's consistent to think that many of the people will not walk away from those cities because they have beheld it so long, it has become, that is what they like. By beholding, we become changed.
Yeah, that, but also, there's going to be a wonderful manifestation. She called it, and I bold-faced it for you. She says it'll be recognized as a manifestation of God's power. Well, what's the manifestation of God's power? It's the history of 1840 to 44. It's a glorious manifestation of God's power. When she said that this work by this angel of light is going to be a manifestation of power, she's saying that this is the counterfeit, this history. And there's Seventh-day Adventists that are going to watch what's going on with this wonderful work in the city, and they're going to get on board. And that's the Omega apostasy. You can dovetail all that information in there as well. Okay, the next quote on the bottom of page 6, just I have it in there because if you understand, this is the last opportunity to get out of the city, and she's talking about out of the cities in this quote. She says to you and I that we need to make haste to get out of the city. Okay, haste, haste. It's time to get out. Now, here's where I wanted to get to. And Brother Rick, you want to read half that, and then Sister Pam can read the second half, the signal for fleeing onward.
Out of the cities, out of the cities.
Doubled for Brother William.
This is the message the Lord has given me. The earthquakes will come, the floods will come, and we are not to establish ourselves in the wicked cities, where the enemy is served in every way, and where God is so often forgotten. The Lord desires that we shall have clear spiritual eyesight. We must be quick to discern the peril that would attend the establishment of institutions in these wicked cities. We must make wise plans to warn the cities, and at the same time live where we can shield our children and ourselves from the contaminating and demoralizing influences so prevalent in these places. Section 9, emergency flight and closer conflict, the signal for fleeing. It is no time now for God's people to be fixing their affections or laying up their treasures in the world. The time is not far distant when, like the early disciples, when we shall be forced to seek a refuge in desolate and solitary places. As the siege of Jerusalem by the Roman armies was the signal for flight to the Judean Christians, So the assumption of power on the part of our nation in the decree enforcing the papal Sabbath will be a warning to us. It will then be time to leave the large cities, preparatory to leaving the smaller ones for retired homes and secluded places among the mountains. And now, instead of seeking expensive dwellings here, we should be preparing to move to a better country, even a heavenly. Instead of spending our means in self-gratification, we should be studying to economize.
Okay, here's the point that I wanted to prepare for the last 5 minutes, okay? Is Sister White says the Sunday law is the sign of the abomination of desolation for God's people. And we used to say right here is where this is fulfilled. Okay? And that's correct in the perfect sense, but now we know it's back here. Okay? But we know there's a sign involved with this. When we see this first Sunday law, I'm saying the first Sunday law, that is the last opportunity to get out of cities. Okay, but that was Cestius. And it's not until 1260 days later that, who's the
Titus
is going to actually destroy Jerusalem. Okay, so this here is the sign. And why was it? You gotta have this sink in your head, I think. Why were the Jews and the disciples, why were they asking Jesus what was the sign? Don't make sure you think through the question. They didn't ask Jesus to explain the fulfillment of the sign. They said, what is the sign? What does that mean? It means when you get to this history, Seventh-day Adventists don't even know what the sign is, which makes it virtually impossible to recognize it if you don't know what it is. If you've rejected the idea fully that Islam has anything to do with Bible prophecy, you're not going to see Islam as a sign. Okay, so the problem with the Jews wasn't that they were arguing about Jesus' interpretation of how the sign had been fulfilled. The problem with the Jews is they did not know what the sign was in the first place. Right? That's why they're asking them, what is the sign? So we don't know what the sign is as Seventh-day Adventists. We don't know that it's Cestius. And what does he do? He comes to the Jerusalem and then he puts his banner of authority there, the Sunday law, the mark of his authority. But then he mysteriously withdraws. Why does he withdraw? Well, that's what happens, but why does Cestius withdraw? Why does a general come and surround a city? He's going to take that city out. He's fear. Fear takes hold on him. He's troubled. He's a king that's troubled in fear. That's Islam produces that fear. Okay? So he withdraws, and when he withdraws, what do the Christians have to do? They have to get out. Okay? Is this a valid application to the midnight cry? Okay, so what it's saying to us, you know, you got some ministries in Adventism that they base their whole ministry upon country living. You know, they can give you the definition of what kind of property you're supposed to look for, and they can tell you all the benefits of country living if you move out there. They can even give you some of the history of the Sunday law in the United States in the 1890s and so on and so forth. But brothers and sisters, if this is valid, and it is, we now have a nuts and bolts message to give to the Adventist church. That's what is approaching. This next president is going to hit this point in time. The next president, whoever he is, the last one, according to Daniel 11, is going to be the one that ushers in the Sunday law, but he's going to be involved with all of this history. This next president is telling you that in his time in office, you are going to have to leave the cities or you're going to die in the cities. And that this is the sign of Jonah for you. It's also the sign of the abomination of desolation. It's a sign of the budding trees of spring. It's all these things. Read the last paragraph. No, I was passing over it. No, I'm not going to. Because we're out of time. But we'll do a little bit more with this tomorrow and then bind it up. Do you get the point? This information about the angel of light typifying when Satan as an angel of light is typifying when Satan personates Christ, that's all good information. What's going on with the cities here is good information, but what this has developed for us is an awareness that we have a responsibility now to awaken Adventism. That there's no option about country living anymore. You need to get out of the cities right now or you're going to die in the cities. That seems like a pretty scary message. Sister Brahman, you want to pray?
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to join here together this morning to open the Word and to learn the signs that we are to recognize. I ask that we don't just recognize them, but we take it to our hearts and change. Give us the power to do that, Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, amen.